Thanks, Ryan, for reading that passage from Exodus 20, talking about Moses and Moses leading the people out of the land of slavery in Egypt into the promised land, and God gives to them those commandments, those Ten Commandments, and we'll take a look at covenants and commands a little bit this morning, but let's pray. God, we give you thanks that your word comes to us in so many different ways. Your word comes to us as it is read from Scripture. It comes to us as it is proclaimed. It certainly comes to us in the gift of music and through conversations with friends and in quiet times in that still small voice. We thank you, God, that your word is life-giving for us. And so now as we focus in and ponder on your word for us today, we ask that it would come alive in our lives, that we would be your people, and that we would live that out for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, if you know me, you know that I am kind of a simple guy. For example, I don't have a lot of things on my bucket list, these big extraordinary things that I want to do. I've always wanted to go to the Holy Land, and so we're planning a trip, and we're going to go this March. That'll be a great, great trip. Another thing that's been on my bucket list for a long time has been to get a hole-in-one in golf. Anybody here have a hole-in-one in golf? Raise your hand. We got a few hole-in-ones. That's been on my bucket list for a long time, to have a hole-in-one. Now, I've been fortunate enough to be present for 6 hole-in-ones. I was thinking about it the other day. 6 other people. It never was off of my club, but I've been able to witness 6 hole-in-ones. I was with my dad one time when he got a hole-in-one. I was with my brother Dan one time when he got a hole-in-one. At a previous congregation in Phoenix, I was golfing with the choir director, and he got a hole-in-one. I was with my friend Mo Redding, and he got a hole-in-one. I was with my other friend Steve Holm, and he got a hole-in-one. And I was together with Greg and with Dave one day here out at Baker Crossing, I think, and one of your friends actually got a hole-in-one. That was a unique hole-in-one in that it was a par 5, but due to some work on the course, it had been shortened to a par 3, and somebody hit, I think, Greg, you hit first, and it landed real close to the hole, and this other gentleman hit the ball, and it hit Greg's ball, and it ricocheted into the hole for a hole-in-one. So I've seen all kinds of hole-in-ones, but I've never gotten one myself. That is until last month. Lori and I were at a pastor and spouse conference. We were suffering for Jesus at Hilton Head Island in South Carolina. And the day after the conference, we played golf. We played golf at the Golden Bear Golf Course. It's a Jack Nicklaus design. There were alligators in the pond. I'm not kidding you. There were alligators there. We were getting the whole kind of Hilton Head, South Carolina experience. And we stepped up to hole number 4, 167 yards. And I had a 6-iron in my hand. And I had been hitting the ball a little short all day long, about a half club short, so I traded it out for a 5-iron. And I took this beautiful swing. Man, I wish I would have had it on video. My son said he doesn't believe it unless he sees it on video, but it really did happen. I hit this beautiful 5-iron shot. It's going straight at the pin. This wasn't one of those hole-in-ones that hit 3 rocks and a tree and ricocheted into the hole. It was going straight at the pin, and then all of a sudden, the ball disappears. And I didn't know. I thought, man, maybe this is it. Maybe it's in the hole. But there was some rough and some hills behind the green, so we weren't sure if it had gone in the hole or if it was behind the green. So I tried to kind of play it a little cool, and I'm walking a little slowly, but I couldn't help myself. So I started walking a lot faster, and Lori and I got up to the green, and she looked in first, kind of like when the disciples ran to the tomb and one of the disciples got there first. She looked in first, and she started screaming, and there it was in the hole. It was a hole-in-one. It was a grand and glorious event. And we can praise God for that today. Let's praise God. And I think there's a picture There I am by the hole, and the ball went in the hole. It was a glorious day. And my dear wife, she put together a display for my office. So I'm going to have that displayed in my office. I think it's a little pretentious to have in your office showing, hey, look how good I was. I got a hole in one. But nonetheless, it's something to celebrate. But then I got to thinking. How many par threes have I played in my lifetime? Now, I don't know for sure, but having golfed on a pretty regular basis year-round in Arizona for many years, and multiple rounds each summer here, and on at least four par threes on every single course, a rough estimate, I was trying to figure it out, is that I've probably played about 6,500 par threes in my life. That's probably a low estimate. So while it's great to celebrate a sweet hole-in-one, that means that I have missed the mark 6,500 times before I got that hole-in-one. Because you're always aiming at the pin, right, in a par three? So it's actually a bit humbling. Today we're talking about covenants, and we're talking about commands. Last week, as I said, Pastor Chris introduced us to Moses and the early part of Moses' life. God calls Moses, if you remember, in the burning bush to lead the people of Israel out of the slavery that they've endured for generations in the country of Egypt. This hard labor, and the Bible says that God heard their cries, and he raised up Moses to be the one to lead them out of slavery. And you remember, after the 10 plagues, Moses parts the Red Sea, and God delivers them. And then soon after that event of the Red Sea, they're there at Mount Sinai, and God gives to them, through Moses, the Ten Commandments. Now, these commandments that we heard Ryan read are good. They are meant to give order to life. Put God first. Don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor your father and mother. Don't kill. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't bear false witness against your neighbor. Don't covet things that aren't yours. It's not healthy for you. It's not good for you. These are good, good commandments. They're commandments given in love, given in grace. The problem is that sometimes, maybe sometimes, we get it right, but much of the time, we don't. Think about the first commandment. God says, you shall have no other gods before me. Now, I confess, I miss the mark on this one much of the time. At times, the lures and the stuff of life crowds out God. At times, my worry, my wife will tell you, at times my worry about things gets the best of me and I get distracted and I forget my important quiet times with God to make sure that God stays first and that God stays on the throne of my life. You see, if we hold up the Ten Commandments kind of as a mirror for us, much of the time we fall short. Unless, of course, there's somebody here who's perfect and gets it right all the time. Anybody want to stand up? Perfect, gets it right all the time? It's like I say to my wife sometimes, honey, why did you choose to marry me anyway? Before we were married, you had a lot of guys interested. Some of them were intelligent, and some of them were very good looking, and some of them were even great athletes. So why me? And she looks at me and she says, Tim, don't you know I didn't want an intelligent, good-looking, athletic guy? She said, I wanted you. You see, none of us is perfect. None of us gets it right all the time. We all fall short of God's glory. Imagine in your wedding vows, in the covenant, that marriage is a covenant. Imagine in your wedding vows if you insisted on the other person being perfect all the time. I don't think that marriage would last even one day. But rather, marriage covenants are based on mutual love and mutual respect and sharing and forgiving. You see, God knows that we fall short of that perfection. We're far from it. The commandments, well, very good for us. Live out those commandments and your life will go much, much better. We are to strive to do that. But we all fall short. They can't save us. Those commandments, that law in the book of Exodus doesn't save us. In fact, ultimately it condemns us when we see that we fall short. So God takes the initiative again. And he gives us a new covenant. He gives us a new promise. This time he shows up on earth. He shows up in the flesh, the Word made flesh, Jesus himself. And Jesus accomplishes for us that which we cannot accomplish for ourselves. Jesus lives that life. He lives that life that we were meant to live before sin and death entered into this world. And God simply says to us, put your faith, put your trust in this one, in Jesus. He's the one who's gone to the cross for you. He's the one who will kill those sins and those imperfections on the cross. And he's the one who's been raised to new life from the dead to raise you up to a new and abundant life. That's what happens in this new covenant that God makes with you and me. It's a covenant that he makes with us at baptism. It's a covenant that he makes with us when we share in Holy Communion. This is the new covenant in my blood, Jesus says. At the 10:30 service, we have a father, Cody, and his young daughter, Millie, are going to be baptized. And in that baptism, God is making a covenant with them. God is saying, I love you. You are my child, and nothing will ever separate you from me. And when you falter, and when you fail, you can talk to me about it, God says, and I'm going to give you forgiveness. Bring it to me. I'll give you grace, and I'll give you my very own Holy Spirit to guide you on this journey. You see, God says to you in this new covenant, I love you. And just like God led the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt, so God too sets you and me free from the slavery that we have to sin and to even death itself. This covenant God makes for us isn't just for this life. It goes on forever and ever in the full presence of Christ. It's a covenant of love that's accessed by faith and trust and a growing relationship with Jesus. So if God does all of this for us, you might ask yourself, then what's my role? Then what's our role in this covenant anyway? First of all, I just want to say simply soak in the reality of God's love. Soak in the reality that you are a child of God, that that is your primary identity as a woman or man or child of God, claimed by God, that he loves you. Your salvation is secure because of your trust in Jesus Christ. He's done that. He has won that for you on the cross. That's great news. Your relationship with God that once was broken by the stuff of sin has now been restored. It has now been put together. So your role is to simply live in that, to know that, to let it soak into your very being. And when that begins to happen and that reality begins to sink in for us, what happens to us is absolutely amazing. We begin to be transformed. These commandments that God has given us, they go from being a rote checklist of do's and don'ts to being written on our hearts, to being part of who we are as new creations in Christ. They become a way of life for us. Things like the fruits of the Spirit begin to show up: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, generosity, self-control. Do you know that in today's American society, you and me, as active followers of Jesus Christ, I'm talking about active followers, active disciples of Jesus Christ, not just those who maybe say that they have some kind of connection to Christianity somehow, but as active Christ followers, we are now in the minority. We're in the minority. So what is Christ calling us to do? What is our role in all of this covenant stuff? Jesus simply says, I want you to be salt. I want you to be salt to give the flavor of God's love to this world. I want you to be light to help bring light into the darkness. There are people walking around that only have a glimmer of hope. They don't know where their hope's going to come from. And you and I have the good news to share with them that there's a God who will claim them, who chooses them, who loves them, who wants to be in relationship with them and gives them hope for abundant life. Friends, as new creations, just as we say at baptism, we are to let our light shine for Christ in so many different ways. I don't know if you've heard about this. Maybe you have. It's kind of gone a little crazy the last week on social media. But last week, at a Minnesota State High School baseball playoff game, there were two outs in the last inning, and the winning team was going to advance to the state tournament. And two outs, there's two strikes on the batter. So if the batter gets out, then the opposing team wins. Well, it just so happened that the pitcher from Moundsview in Minnesota was good friends, actually childhood friends. They had grown up together with the person he was pitching against, the batter. And maybe you've seen this, but I just want you to take a look at this clip and watch this act of love and kindness and compassion by the pitcher after he strikes out his opponent. Take a look.
We end tonight with the final play of a baseball game because, as you're about to see, it was one class act. Here's Jim Axelrod.
The most talked about strikeout in the country has nothing to do with winning and losing. Minnesota high school pitcher Ty Kane has provided us all a masterclass in how you play the game.
I never thought a story like this would blow up the way it did.
Last week, Ty's team advanced to the state tournament when he struck out Jack Kokin looking on a 2-2 fastball that nicked the outside corner.
I really felt for him, and I just felt it was right to go over there and say something.
That's right. Watch Ty. While his teammates from Moundsview High erupted in celebration, Ty waved off his own catcher to attend to more pressing business, hugging the kid he had just struck out.
I didn't think. I just ran over there. It was instinct.
After all, Ty and Jack have been pals since they were 13 and teammates on the same travel team. They stayed close even after heading off to different high schools.
And I said, you had a great season. You were a great player. Don't let this outcome affect our friendship. And I told him I loved him and he's my brother. And our friendship will always last longer than this silly game.
The hug has become a social media sensation, which just may say something about our thirst these days for examples of how to treat each other with class, grace, and empathy.
There's a thirst for class. There's a thirst for grace. There's a thirst for empathy. There's a thirst for Christ followers shining their light in this world and maybe acting a little bit differently than the rest of society, because we are now a minority in this country. And God wants us to share that good news. Friends, God has made a covenant of love with you. Through faith in Christ, as I said, your salvation is secure. But he meets you right here, and he meets you right now with the gift of his Holy Spirit. He empowers you, knowing that you have been set free, to live for the sake of God, to give glory to God, but to live for the sake of others. This extraordinary God of ours is turning this world that is so upside down in so many ways. He's turning it right side up again, and he's using ordinary people like Moses, like you, like me. So I don't know about you, but I say that we leave this place today and we go out and we have some fun being joyfully and boldly a little bit different than the rest of society. Taking things like compassion and kindness and forgiveness and joy to heart, because that's who we are as people who Christ has redeemed and loves and rose again for. So let's go out being ambassadors for this God who has created a covenant of grace and a covenant of love with us and with his church and with his world. In Christ's name, amen. Now may the peace of God, that peace which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.